Today on Coding 101, it's all about regular expressions, like happy and sad
and angry. Stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Coding 101 is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Coding 101 is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. For a free 2-week trial and 10% off, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code CODING. And by hover.com. Hover is the best place to buy and manage domain names. It's simple, honest, and easy to use. For 10% off your first purchase, go to hover.com and enter the promo code C101. Welcome to Coding 101. It's the Twitch show where we let you into the wonderful world of the code monkey. I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
And I am Shannon Morse. And for the next 30 minutes, we are going to tell you all about everything you need to know to get all coded up and be a code warrior in the world of Perl.
Now, before we get to that, Shannon, there's a couple of house cleaning items we have to take care of because we've actually been gone for a while.
We have, yeah. Like I had to do this marriage thing.
Yeah, you got married. I mean, whatever. We have a show to do, but fine. If you want to take a day off from getting married, whatever.
Work smirk.
Yeah. Well, but we did do the first two episodes of the Perl module back to back, and as a result, I have a mea culpa here, which was my show notes, which I thought I had wonderfully packed up before I went away for 2 weeks of vacation and work, turned out they didn't work out.
Yeah, so I went to the Twit site and I was like, where are show notes?
Yeah, so that's my bad. I'm sorry about that, folks. I will get that fixed. And actually, I this is a good time for me to reconfigure it. There are a few people in our Google Plus community who are trying to move us to a better way to use GitHub, using something like markup. And some of it looks really, really promising. So I'm going to toy around with it for the next week or so and see if there's not a better way for us to put our notes and our code into one place. Because right now it's kind of split.
Cool. Yes, it is. Yeah. We have our show notes over on twit.tv, and then we have our actual code over on GitHub. Yeah. But I didn't think you could use GitHub for more than just uploading the files.
You're not supposed to, but evidently some people have figured it out. And it looks good. Cool. So I will be jumping around. I will be trying a few things. I'm not going to do it immediately because I don't want to switch to a new system and then find out that the system won't do everything we want to do. But I think we can all agree that the way we're doing it right now is a little cumbersome, especially for first-time coders. So we're going to try to find a better way for you to get all of our code and all of our notes in one simple spike.
I think that sounds great.
I like that. Yeah. There is something else that we wanted to do. One of the things that we pride ourselves on is our community, right?
Oh, yeah. I love our community.
It's a big part of who we are. It's a big part of what we do. We try to drive people to our G+ community because it's filled with really bright engineers, with really bright programmers, and it's just a good place to hang out if you want to learn the craft. Well, there are some people in our community who are very vocal, and they would like a go at teaching a 101 level course. And you know what? I'm not one to say no. So here's what we're going to do. The first one who approached me was a man who's in the community by the name of Joe Hecht. He's been with us since the very beginning. Code for Sale, I believe, is the moniker that he uses. But he's an expert programmer. And what I want to do is I want to give him two episodes on a Friday to be able to do the show the way he wants. This is not a challenge, folks. This is not, oh yeah, we'll put up or shut up. I honest to goodness want him to be able to do the best job that he can, and maybe we'll take some pointers on how we guide Coding 101.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah. Some time, because
I was on Before You Buy, I had people come on and do guest reviews.
Exactly. Yeah, that's how it works. Yeah. I mean, and no one's ever got the market on how you teach, so we want to hear new ideas. Now, it's going to take us a while to get this set up because we got to get the logistics worked out because it's not a standard Coding 101 episode. So we have to make sure I've got time, and I have to make sure we have a format down, because, you know, obviously you work most of the time away from Twit. So stay with us. We will figure this out, and we will make sure that we include more of our audience, because that's who we are, right?
Yay!
We're nothing without our audience.
Speaking of which, we do have some guest feedback, some guest programming codes. I'm really excited about these, because it's been so many weeks since I've actually gotten to play with them. So we got a couple of really cool ones in our Google Plus community. Of course, if you haven't checked that out, it's over at gplus.to/twitcoding101.
Wow, gone for 3 weeks and still pulls it right off the top here. I love that.
But I wanted to go ahead and start off with a very simple code that I decided to do to just review what we've learned so far. Now, obviously, there is tons that you can learn from Perl episode 1 and Perl episode 2 that we've already done in our module. But if you're just catching up, I can go ahead and show you what I've done so far. So let me go ahead and pull up this code on my computer. And if you want to pull up my computer, please. Thank you, sir. So if I just click on this, it's going to ask me who my favorite Doctor Who companion is. My personal favorite is Amy, so I'm gonna type in Amy.
Now those are fighting words.
Oh snap, you said Amy, I agree.
Gee, I wonder who programmed
this. Amy rocks.
Okay.
Of course, if you do come back in here and you say your favorite ends up being Rose, it says, they were okay. And I say they because there are some males.
Yeah, of course.
They were okay, I guess, but the best was obviously Amy, obviously. And then just hit enter to close. Now, if I go over here and hit edit to actually view the code, and I'll pull this up so you can see all of it. I did include comments this time. I know some people wanted to see comments, so I did include those. Not very many, but it's a pretty simple code. So you basically just print out at the beginning who's your favorite Doctor Who companion, slash n to enter onto a new line. Companion equals standard input. So this is the user's input. We're going to call it companion, whatever they end up inputting into the programming code. Now, if the companion equals Amy or Amelia, so down here it says if the companion is equal to or has Amy included in the code or in their input, then it'll say, you said Amy, I agree, Amy rocks. Same thing for Amelia. And last week we did learn that G means global, so it's going to look at all of their input and look for specifically A-M-Y in line. And then the I basically means it doesn't care if it's uppercase or lowercase.
Right.
So I could put this all in upper caps like that, it doesn't matter. It'll still read it out. I agree, Amy rocks.
Now, I'm glad that you point that out. We should point out the fact that those little qualifiers that you can add to the end of regular expression formulae are incredibly important, because that's one of the things that makes RegEx, however you want to call it, so powerful in Perl, because it lets you search through, as you're doing here, any string, any piece of data, any file, looking for a particular a thing that you want to match or replace. And that's what you're doing.
So that was the if part of my command. I also have the else statement down here. If you do not put in Amy or Amelia into your standard input, then it'll just say, you said whoever you actually did put in, and then meh, they're okay, I guess, but the best was obviously Amy. And then an enter.
So dismissive.
And at the very end, it just waits for the user to hit the enter key to close it out.
And remember, there are other ways to make it wait than using standard input.
Yes, there are.
That's the way we're doing it. If you use another method, that's fine, go ahead. It's not gonna hurt our feelings, but standard is actually my favorite.
It's a good one. Yeah, it's easy and it's the one that I learned, so I'm going to use it. Now, we also got two more in our Google Plus community. Again, gplus.to/twitcoding101. Go subscribe because it's super, super fun. Now, the first one is from Jerry Coffee, and he said this is a simple math trick that he decided to do in Perl. And it totally works, and it kind of freaked me out, but I'm going to show you it anyway. All right, Jerry math trick. So think of a number. So I'm going to think of...
I hate these.
I know.
I really do.
So I'm thinking of 8. Press enter when you're ready. Multiply that number by 2, so it would be 16. Press enter. Add 10 to that number, so it would be 26. Divide that by 2, so that would be 13. Subtract your original from the last, so that would be 13 minus 8, and that equals what,
5?
5. And then it says, wait, I'm reading your mind.
And he's a witch.
The answer is 5.
Now, of course, this is just math. It's just having fun with math. We always remember it. But it's kind of fun to see that in code.
It is. It's super, super cute. And it's a pretty easy code to do, too. It's basically just taking a bunch of standard inputs, which are your enters, and then giving you different output each time. At the very end, here we see that he sleeps it for 1 second. So that's something new that we haven't stepped on yet, but sleep for one. And you could obviously change that to two, three, or whatever you wanted to do. So it doesn't do anything for 1 second. Pretty cool entry right there.
And it also,
and then
you know,
it just says the answer is five.
The ability to pause is sort of the start of animation in a programming language. Anytime you can pause, you can add motion. It's a clunky way to do it, but I've seen people do some awesome things with pausing and ASCII animation. So
I like it. I think it's pretty neat. Yeah. Our second one and the last one for today is from Daryl Medley, and this is an Animal Farm sounds program. So if I open up this one, click on farm. Okay, so first off, I'm going to list all the animals on Daryl's farm. So click list, and it shows you all the animals he has on his farm. He has some good internets for his farm. I'm going to say sheep. So I enter sheep, and then it says, the sheep says, ba-ba. That's it. Cow. Cow says, moo.
Are there any snubs on this farm?
Pig. Oink, oink. Snubs.
Oh,
sorry. It doesn't have a snub.
So sad.
And then you can just leave it blank and hit enter for it to exit. That's it.
Yeah. Okay. Now, this seems really simple, but some people were freaking out, and rightfully so, over the regular expression.
Yes.
So we're going to spend a lot of time this episode talking about regular expression. In fact, one of the things I think was a mistake on my part was we didn't give enough time to our code warrior to really go through regular expression, give you all the different ways you can use it, and explain why it's so important. So we're going to be looking forward to that in just a bit. But before we get to that module, I wanted to do one more thing that came to us.
Uh-oh.
From our community.
Oh, boy. What's going on?
It's the lighter side of programming.
Oh, the lighter side? This is new.
Yes. So Colin Nelson brought this to our attention in our G+ community for Coding 101. I don't know if you've got that link up, Brian, but he wanted us to take a look at a language that was created by some geeks, obviously some very bored geeks, who created a new programming language based entirely off of Arnold Schwarzenegger's catchphrases.
Oh, my gosh.
Now, for no reason whatsoever, they've created Arnold C that allows you to call functions and methods and procedures commands like listen to me very carefully, which declares methods, or get your ass to Mars, which assigns variables from methods. Now, if you go to go to the actual code itself, to the GitHub, even Hello World is interesting. It uses for print, talk to the hand. And of course, every program ends with you have been terminated. So
that's awesome.
No reason to create something like this, but it just shows that, yeah, programmers have a sense of humor too.
Programmers are weird.
Okay, so hey, programming experts, if you could make us a Harry Potter language, that would be awesome.
Wait, is there not already a Harry Potter
spells
language?
How spells. Awesome would it be to have spells?
Oh, that's a great idea.
Seriously, right?
Yes, I like
okay,
it.
Okay, no, that's a horrible idea.
I
mean, it'd be fun.
I like it.
I'd do it.
I don't remember any.
It just reminds me of when I, you know, my college days, and there was always that one geek who hated all of the compilers, so he wrote his own. It's like, why would you do that?
Well, you know, a site is online, and it's available to you that enables you to not have to learn code.
I would like that, yeah. Because, you know, sometimes you just want to use what's there. Sometimes you just want easy.
Yeah, sometimes you just want easy. And luckily, we have a site called Squarespace. Over at squarespace.com, it's the one-stop platform for everything that you ever need for all of your wonderful programming websites and all those needs. So, Squarespace is the all-in-one platform that makes it easy to create or build your own professional website or online portfolio. Some of the reasons why you're gonna love Squarespace, because I know you will, they're constantly improving their platform with new features, new designs, and even better support. And they have beautiful designs. There's over 25 beautiful templates for you to quickly build your own personal and business site. And they also have a really good mobile experience too. So say you're on the go and you wanna check out your website or check out a friend's website and they're using Squarespace, they've developed templates with responsive designs. So they'll know if you're on your smartphone, your tablet, your computer, and they'll be able to make it look pretty for you. And it's super easy to use, just like Padre said. So if you want some help, Squarespace has a live chat and email support 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Plus, there's a completely redesigned customer help site for easier access to self-help articles and video workshops. Guess what? Your hosting is included.
No.
Yeah, you don't have to go to a second site and sign up for hosting. It's right there on Squarespace. They take care of the hosting. They have a distributed network that does not go down, too, so you're always up no matter what. Even when they had some crazy stuff going on in New York and, like, their basement flooded. They took care of you.
I love that story.
I remember the Bucket Brigade of Fuel. My site was still up, and I was like, yes! And not to mention, it's really inexpensive. I'm not going to say cheap, because cheap sounds bad. No. It's inexpensive. You know, it's good quality, and it's inexpensive. It's only $8 a month, and that includes a free domain name if you sign up for a year. So definitely sign up for a year. It's totally a good choice, good value. And their code is gorgeous. They take so much pride in their back-end code, just as much as they do in the front end. So you're going to get an excellent design, excellent professional quality, whether you're a coder or you just used to work on terrible
just
sites when you were in high
just
school.
Some dude, yeah.
Like me. And they also have a developer platform. If you really want to dig into site customization and developer accounts that never expire while in development. So you can take as much time as you need before launching your site, and you can pay nothing until you actually go live. Their developer platform features include complete control. So you can edit all the code that affects the display of your website, every line of HTML, CSS, JavaScript, it's all under your control. And they also have a repository for Git and SFTP. With version control that comes standard, you can connect to template files via Git or SFTP, and developer tools, so there's less pre-processing, there's JSON templating, script comboing, retina-ready responsive image handling, and so much more. So you're pretty much getting like the whole shebang on Squarespace, so you're good to go. So start a free 2-week trial with no credit card required, and start building your website. When you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure to use the offer code CODING, that's CODING, get 10% off, and show your support of Coding 101. Of course, we thank Squarespace for their support of Coding 101, and remember, a better web awaits, and it all starts with your new Squarespace website. Thank you, Squarespace. I love my site, and you guys do an awesome job.
We love you, Squarespace.
We love them.
Thank you.
I put my wedding website on Squarespace.
What? Really?
Yeah, I did.
Wait, how come you haven't sent me the link?
I didn't share it with anybody because it had all right. the details
on there.
That's
going to work.
I didn't want crazy people showing up.
Oh, I get it. No, there are no crazy people on the internet.
Yeah, it was on Squarespace. Internet. Super easy. Yeah, no crazies.
Yeah. Okay, let's get past the crazies. And for a second, let's talk about the regular expression. Now, I know that in episode 2 of the Perl module, we kind of glossed over regular expression. I'm really sorry. The feedback that we have gotten is that we should not have done that. My bad. I thought regular expression was sort of a no-brainer. It was something that was going to be simple. Obviously, we should have spent more time on it, and that's what we're going to do this episode. Now, Snubs. Mm-hmm. We've done expressions. You've seen expressions, right? Like whenever we're talking about conditions, like for if-then loops, or if-then statements, or for loops, we're talking about an expression that's being used in some sort of comparison, right?
Right.
For example, if is x is equal to y, or if y is less than 2. Those could be considered expressions, but we're using a conditional operator to figure out what kind of action we want to take with that expression. A regular expression is really not that much different. That's why we thought people would get it right away. And it's looking at a string and trying to find patterns. Okay, let's break that down just a tiny bit. So when we talk about a regular expression or a regex or a regex, depending on how you want to call it, but when you're talking, it's probably easier to call it regular expression because no one will get mad at your pronunciation. It's a type of pattern matching that can be used in searches to find and replace operations.
Oh.
Okay, so.
Interesting.
Yeah, if we break that down even further, in a regular expression, each character in a string becomes its own metacharacter, right? And you can combine metacharacters in order to create something that will be searched for within any piece of data. It could be a single string, it could be an entire file, it could be the entire internet. That's one of the nice things about using
That's
a regular
weird.
Expression. Yeah, it's weird, but let me explain why that works.
Okay.
Regular expressions can be used in most modern languages. Now, Perl is sort of like the standard bearer, right? The type of regular expression that's used in Perl is also used in Java. It's used in JavaScript. It's used in Ruby. It's used in .NET.
Really?
So, yeah.
Wow.
So if you learn how to do it in Perl, you're going to understand regular expressions in all those other languages.
Oh, that's awesome. That could be very handy.
Now, what does this all mean when we talk about metacharacters and strings and search things?
Yes.
Quite simply, a regular expression allows you to find, to match, and to replace any string or piece of string within anything.
Really?
Yeah, which is why Perl becomes so popular with web developers, because a lot of web development is about data manipulation. It's about looking through stuff and replacing it with something else.
That totally makes sense now.
Yeah. Now, you also see regular expressions a lot in search engines. The search engine algorithms, the way that you look for it, it's based on a regular expression. I mean, when you think about
it. Yeah, that makes sense, though. They're looking through that string and trying to find something that matches it.
Right. Now, if we, before regular expressions, imagine if you were using a search engine that would only work if you exactly matched it.
Oh, God.
Okay, yeah, right?
That would be irritating.
It would be hugely irritating. And
I would never get anything done.
Exactly. So, like, for example, if I'm looking for something about, Google I.O., right? I would have to worry about, did I put Google I.O. as all one word? Did I space it? Did I have a slash? Did I have 2014? I don't have to do that with a regular expression. I can say, look, the string, the connection of metacharacters I'm looking for is Google and I.O. Mm-hmm. Search the entire internet for that particular string and bring me back all the results that match.
So that's why whenever we use like Google, it'll say, you know, it'll give you whatever kind of output it's able to find for all those search queries. And then up at the top, it'll be like, we also found these search queries for Google and I.O.
Right, it contained the string, right?
Yeah.
Did you mean blah, blah, blah?
Yes.
And that's all a regular expression. In fact, we've got Dexter in the chat room who's saying, hey, RegEx is great for spam filtering email. Absolutely.
Ah.
We know the phrases that spammers use, right?
That's true, yeah.
So you have spam filters that are searching the entire stack of emails for particular combinations that we know to be used in spam emails. And then we set aside that entire email. So it's fantastically useful. Even if you don't exactly know how it works yet, you should understand that in your daily life, if you do anything on the internet, you're using regular expressions.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. Yay, back end.
Yay, back end. Now, here's the thing. What we need to do is we need to be able to tell you not only why regular expressions are useful, why they're important, but we know we got to give people some syntax, right?
Oh,
I mean, You use it in yours.
I did. I used some syntax.
But we don't want people to just think it's this magical line. You put that there, and that's why it works, and it brings back good things.
No, but that always works for me.
It always works for you, but it won't necessarily work for our audience, which is why in just a second we're going to bring in our code warrior, Patrick Delahanty.
Yay.
What he's going to do is he's actually going to sit us down and he's going to guide us through step by step what a regular expression contains, what it looks like, and the different operators that we can use within a regular expression. Does that sound like something
we
want to do?
Yes, that sounds great. I'm so excited.
Yeah, and it's also, you know, if this is what our audience wants. You know, their feedback.
If you better understand something, obviously, it's going to make you a lot smarter whenever you have to deal with those kind of
Absolutely.
Things.
Absolutely, yeah. You know what else makes you smarter?
What makes everything?
Well, no, specifically, what makes you smarter is doing the same amount of work but with less work.
Oh, yeah. I like being able to do that.
Any smart people, that's like the definition
of
smart,
right? You got
something
that will save me some time?
I think I do. Because, yeah, I mean, you're a citizen of the internet, right?
Yes,
so
I
you
am.
Like domains, right?
Yes.
And you know that domains are important, right?
I like domains.
I mean, is there anything more frustrating than not getting the domain that you want?
That's happened to me.
Yeah, or, you know, having to create that super lame extra name.
Oh, totally.
Like, let's say I want my website to be called Snubs, and it's Snubs235.
Snubs is taken.
No. Ooh, very good, actually. Thank you. Snubs is taken. But no, folks, what I'm talking about is I'm talking about a company, a sponsor of Coding 101 that's going to help you cut your work down when you're looking for domains.
Yay.
It's Hover. Now, you want to secure a domain for your great idea. You want something catchy and memorable to represent your online identity. Hover gives you exactly what you need to get that done. You'll find the perfect domain for your idea so you can get started working on it and move on to the next thing on your to-do list. Now, people love Hover, folks. They're a two-cows company. This goes way, way back. If you're a geek, you know about this company. When you're looking for the best place to register a domain, you ask the people who know a lot about domains. Now, geeks, developers, designers, and programmers all love Hover because they know that they'll have the best tools and support. But you don't have to be an expert to get a domain. The service is simple enough to use that you'll be comfortable figuring it out by yourself. And the support team is always ready to give you a hand if you need it. Now, Hover, their thing is that they take all the hassle and the friction out of registering a domain. They give you easy-to-use, powerful tools to manage that domain so anyone can do it. And they also get you the perfect domain, not that janky one that's sort of a second or third choice, but it lets you get the one that you want and start building your web presence right away to take control of what people find when they search for you using regular expressions or for your business online. Now, it's easy. All you have to do is search for a few keywords, and Hover will show you the best available options and suggestions. Again, this is one of those services that you don't necessarily have to know exactly what you want. You just have to tell Hover what you want it to represent, and they'll give you that match. They have a clean and simple website. In less than 5 minutes, you can find the domain name that you want and get it running. And they've got a huge variety of domain extensions like .com, .net, and country codes to best suit your needs. So you can get, dot just about anything. They also offer valet transfers to make the process painless if you've already got your domain registered elsewhere. For free, Hover will take care of the entire process for you and let you know when your domains are settled in your Hover account. They'll transfer all your DNS settings or MX settings, no matter how many domain names you have. It's no additional cost. Well, folks, the big thing for me is honesty. I want someplace that's honest, and that's Hover. They don't believe in heavy-handed upselling or charging you for something that should be part of your service. They include everything you need with your domain, no more and no less, including a custom email, even for cranky hippo. You'll get a smart control panel so you can do what you want with your domain with a click of a button, and whose privacy is included free on every domain that supports it. So if you ever need a hand, you know that Hover is going to be there because they have the best customer service around. And now Hover offers volume discounts. They'll give you a discount on your domain renewal, starting at just 10 domains, then going up in value from there. The idea is the more domains you have in your account, the less you should have to pay to renew them. So here's what we want to do, folks. We want you to try Hover. We want you to see if it's easy for you, for me, for Shannon, for Cranky Hippo, as it is for the rest of the world. Visit Hover today to register your domain name. And for 10% off your first purchase, go to hover.com and use our promo code C101. We thank Hover for their support of Coding 101.
We should not allow Brian.
We really should. This is what happens when you let your TD run free.
Crankyhippo.sexy.
It actually was our code warrior who was in charge of that.
Oh, that was. Yeah. Okay. See, this is what we know. Well, you know what?
Code warrior.
This is a good time as any to bring our code warrior back in, fresh from his trip to Tahiti. It's Mr. Patrick Delahanty, folks. He's one of the engineers, programmer here at Twit TV, and he's our Perl guru.
Yes, Tahiti, it's a magical place.
It's also known as Petaluma.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
They're so similar to each other.
Yeah. Now, Patrick, now, I know that you went over regular expressions. We went over regular expressions really quickly in episode 2. Let's slow down just a tiny bit. Go over every nook and cranny. They know the theory. They understand what it is. But now we need to show them exactly how it works in Perl.
Yeah. I wouldn't say we went over it. We just kind of touched on it.
We used it.
And this episode and the next one are all things with regular expressions.
Wait, why would we do that? Why would we dedicate 2 episodes to regular expressions?
Because there's so much to do with it. And it's kind of confusing, but you can search on it, you can replace, and...
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. Very powerful. I want to make sure that I get it down before we actually move on to harder stuff.
Yeah. So bring us in there.
All right. So I've got... last week I had the code, and I'll just run it now. The one where you enter the name of your favorite animal.
Donkey.
Yeah, donkey.
Bunny.
Might remember this. You said donkey. Okay, whatever. Well, I've modified this, and I'll actually run it again. This time we'll say my favorite animal is cat. You said rabbit.
What?
So I used a regular expression, and this will give you another hint of how I did this. My favorite animal? Thunder cat. You said thunder. So in this, I've used a regular expression to modify any time anybody enters cat to replace it with rabbit. So if I do it again, I say...
Oh, no. Oh, boy. Oh,
there we go. I said, Sarah Lane likes cats, and it comes out Sarah Lane likes rabbits.
Okay, now, Patrick, I got to ask, it's a cool example, but would this actually be useful in the real programming world?
Oh, absolutely. You may be normalizing some data. You may want to say, okay, they've entered this. I want to replace any time this has been entered with this. let's say that they've entered something with those smart quotes and you want to replace it with normal quotes. You can search for those smart quotes and replace it with the normal one.
That's okay, now I get it. That's fantastically
smart quotes,
useful.
You drive me nuts.
All right, show me how this works.
All right, if we look at the code here, this is pretty much the same program we had last time. But here, I've added this search and replace line, this one line. It says, it takes the input, which is animal,
right,
and then it has this equals tilde, but then it has the S slash, which tells it search, and this is going to be a search and replace. So I'm searching for cat, replacing it with rabbit. And the G and the I, it's global and case insensitive, just like before. And down here we have the if statement. This is the same as last week. I haven't modified that at all. So we're still looking for if it says bunny or if it says rabbit, and it says you said.
Okay, Patrick, so let me ask you this. I mean, I see how this works. So let's go up a line.
Yep.
To animal is equal to S slash cat slash rabbit slash GI.
Yes.
All right, I understand cat, rabbit. Cat is what it's searching for. Rabbit is what's going to replace it with. I understand G, so it's looking through everything. It's the global. And I is the case, correct?
Yes.
Okay. But why S? Why do you have to specify search in this line, but you don't have to do it in the next line with the if statement?
Because here it's telling Perl that it's a search and replace, whereas down below, it's just checking to see if it's in there.
Oh.
So up here, we have to tell it this S slash because we're saying, okay, this is going to look for something and immediately replace it with this other thing.
Got it.
Oh.
Down here, we're just looking for that thing.
So without the S, it's just a standard search. It's just seeing whether or not that particular string is there. If you add the S, it's going to search and then it's going to replace whatever it finds.
Yes.
Okay.
And so we've got two. I mean, this is all still regular expressions. This is just two ways to handle it. And you can do a lot more complicated things with. You don't have to put in the actual words. You can do other things, and I've got a couple examples of those. If we're ready to move on to that. Do you have any other questions about this before you take another step? Yeah.
Could I put the G and the I before cat and rabbit, and would it still work?
No, that wouldn't work.
Okay.
So what's the particular syntax you have to use? I mean, I get why it's working the way you put it, but for the folks at home who are doing this for the first time, we want to move them past the black box stage. Is there a particular pattern that they have to follow when they want to start using regular expressions?
Basically, what they would do is they would always have the equals tilde, and that tells it it's going to be a regular expression thing.
Okay.
And then if it's in an if statement, you're only looking to see if the string is inside or the string contains that word. So you wouldn't do a search and replace. So you would have like that.
Don't search and replace Padre.
So this would be searching for Padre within a string. And then at the end, the G is search the entire string or just find it once, and then the I is case insensitive. So if I had lowercase Padre, uppercase, doesn't matter.
Right.
Now, if I put this here, this tells Perl that, okay, I need to look for something and replace it with whatever's after
that. So I need to tell it what to replace it with.
So,
like snubs, of course.
Yeah, so I couldn't just put the GI there because it would say, okay, this is not valid. There's
so
nothing.
So it's thinking that you want to replace it with GI.
Yeah, even the highlighting here, it's like, okay, well, this isn't done yet. so I would place it with
naturally.
And then there would be that.
Ah.
And so this would say, okay, in the whole string and whatever the case, replace Padre with snubs.
Right. Now, I understand why global case insensitive is there and why it's useful. Where would you leave it off? Where is there a case where you wouldn't want it to be global and you wouldn't want it to be case insensitive?
In the search and replace, the global comes into play a lot more often because if I left that out, it would only replace the first occurrence.
Okay.
So if I, actually, let me make that change. And I'll put, I haven't tried this. Let's hope this works. Favorite animal, cat and dog and cat. You said, so see, it only replaced the first one. You said rabbit and cat and dog and cat.
Okay, so that's.
But if I modify this again and put the G, it should globally replace and cat and cat and dog.
Right.
Yes, and rabbit and rabbit and rabbit and dog.
And just for giggles, I think we should show them what happens if you take out the caps in sensitivity and then add a couple of caps just they understand why that's in there.
So we'll take that case insensitivity out. Now it's case sensitive, so I'll put cat and cat and cat and under cat. So it replaced the second one because it had it was all lowercase.
Right.
It didn't touch the third one, and the fourth one, cat was part of the phrase, so it replaced that part.
Yeah. So hopefully the folks at home will see what those qualifiers do. You put that in there. You put the G for the global when you want to do a search beyond just a single term, and you always have to make it case insensitive unless you only want to replace or search for exact capitalization match.
I only want exact kitties.
Thank you. All right. So let's move us on. What else do you got?
I have another example here. Let's run this. And whoop, that's Emacs.
That made a lot of sense.
Yes.
Good.
We like that.
Thank you.
Here we go. This is, what is your favorite movie quote? Do you have
get
one?
Get your ass to Mars.
Get your ass
sorry,
to
I'm in,
Mars.
I'm in the Arnold mode.
And so what I did here
was
I replaced all the spaces with new lines. So if we look at the code here, this is very simple.
Whoa.
What?
Okay.
That doesn't look very simple.
I've got a regular expression here. It's the same thing. And previously this said cat and this said bunny.
Yeah.
But what I'm doing here is I've got this backslash S and then backslash N.
So
and
I as know we've what discussed, backslash N does.
Yeah, we've talked about backslash N before, and that's new line. So that's obviously. Yeah.
We know what the first S does. We know we're going to be doing some search and replace.
Yes,
we know what the G does. We know it's going to be global. But now you've got this smiley face in the middle, Patrick. What are you trying to pull?
this backslash S, and it's a backslash, not a slash. But that is a regular expression term to search for a space.
Okay.
So this is looking for any space in the string, and the G tells it all of the spaces in the string, and it's replacing all of those spaces with backslash N, which is a new line.
Oh, that's cool.
And so then I just print it out. I've got this spacer with three dashes, a new line, and then I print the quote.
That's phenomenally important to be able to do, because you just gave me a way to take a sentence from someone and divide it up into its component parts.
Yes.
That's amazing. I mean, seriously, I could think of a very simple program that we could give people, which would be to use this function to do a counter, to find out how many words are in a paragraph. That would be something perfect, because you could use that to separate it out into its pieces and then count the pieces.
Yes, you could easily do like an if statement. I mean, I did search and replace, but you could say if quote contains a space, then do something. So do something here.
Yeah.
And so, that means, you entered a space. And think about how you could use this to say, you entered an email address with a space. That's not valid. And so you can... There's all sorts of error checking that can be based off of this too.
Oh, that's cool. You could do that even on if a person enters a phone number incorrectly or their social security number.
You could use this to strip out spaces from a phone number.
Yeah.
Like up here, I've got the replace it with the backslash N. If I just leave that blank, it's stripping all the spaces out.
Oh.
And the other thing that you could do, Patrick, you don't have to strip out spaces. Like, for example, let's say that you wanted to take out periods. For example, someone types in their phone number with like 202 dot blah, 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 dot blah, blah, blah. You could use this to just strip out the period so you get nothing but the numbers.
Yes, but you have to be careful about the non-alphanumeric characters in regular expressions. If I just put a period, that is actually a special character for regular expressions. That a period matches any character.
Oh.
We would have to give it the character code so it knows what to look
for. Yes, so if I did, let me say I did...
So that kind of reminds me of wild cards.
It does, kind of, right? So, okay, so you're doing a search and replace on Shannon.Morse.
And Shannon, any character Morse.
Ah.
And replace it with.
Oh, I like that. Okay, so anytime you see Shannon Morse, you're going to replace it with snubs.
Yep. So if I ran this, we'd type Shannon Morse, it would say snubs. If I run it again, I type
Shannon. And put a random number in there?
One.
Yeah.
Morse. Snubs. It matches.
Cool.
And it replaces it with that. The period is literally any character. So the way around that would be to put a backslash before, and now it knows, okay, it's just a period.
Right.
So now when I enter something, it's going to take all the periods out, backslash period. It's going to look for just the actual period, the dot, and replace it with nothing. So if I run this again, oops, Emacs.
Stop it, Emacs.
save, yes. Okay. So I'm going to look for anything with periods. So let's just enter a phone number. We'll have 207-786-2411.
Dude, that's my phone number.
That's time and temperature in Lewiston, Maine.
Okay.
So we'll take that, replace it. It takes out all the dots.
Oh, that's so handy. I love it.
Now, folks, now you should be able to see the utility of doing this. What we're talking about is data sanitation.
Yes.
You know, we're making the data the way we want it so then we can run it through some program that makes it useful.
Yes.
And because I was looking specifically for periods, when I put it in the dash, it doesn't do that.
Right.
That makes sense.
But you could write another regular expression that takes away the dashes.
Yeah.
You can do another regular expression that takes away
parentheses.
Strange characters that people might put in.
Speaking of strange characters, we could do, like you saw the matching on a space. We could do capital S for non-space. So that means any characters I've entered that aren't a space or aren't a new line.
Got it.
Anything that is visible, really.
The S is for strange?
capital ones are for non-whatever.
Right.
A lowercase is for that. So capital S is for non-space. S is for space. D is digit. So 0 through 9. So I can search for any digits and remove them.
Oh.
Capital D is non-digit, so A, B, C, dash, period, whatever. W is for letters and numbers, alphanumerics. So this would match A through Z and 0 through 9,
right.
Wouldn't match plus, dollar sign, and stuff like that, exclamation mark.
I think at this point, now that they understand what regular expressions are and how they use them, I think what we need to do is we need to recommend that they find an online listing of all the different regular expression modifiers that you can use in order to get what you want. We've got a lot of questions in the chat room from people who are asking, well, can you use this to get rid of double characters? Yes, you can. You just need to figure out exactly how the process is going to work.
Oh.
Can I use it to get rid of parentheses? Of course you can. Again, it's all going to come down to problem solving. Now that you know what regular expressions do and what they can do, you have to figure out how to make them solve your problem.
Yes.
Nice.
Now, there's another thing I want to point out here. I had this slash S. If we put a plus after it, that means it has to find at least one. But if there's more than one, it'll match that too.
Right.
So this would take multiple spaces. So if I had Shannon Morse, if I had one space in there or 100 spaces, it would replace them all. It would match that.
Fantastic.
So.
Now, Patrick, I got to ask. I mean, we want to cover more regular expressions next week, but what else is left? I mean, it would seem as if you've given us the basics. You've given us enough to get working. Well, what else do we need to know?
There's a lot more with regular expressions that we can cover, including how to actually take something that's matched and include it in the response. So we could take. I'll get into it next week. But also, I wanted to cover probably the most useful line of Perl that you can ever use. And even if you don't plan to do Perl programming, beyond this module, you'll still use this line for years to come. It's a search and replace with Perl on the command line. And it's the most useful line I've ever learned of any programming. And I can't wait to show it.
Oh my gosh.
Wow, that's not a tease at all.
No,
wow.
Not at all.
Patrick, we want to thank you so very much for being our code warrior. And thank you for bringing some sanity to regular expression. Because again, anytime we can bring it out of the black box and actually show people how to create these expressions rather than just using the ones that we give them, that's always a good thing. So thank you so very much. Can you tell the folks at home where they can find you?
You can find me. I'm on Twitter at pdelahanty. And again, my website, animecons.com and fancons.com, all written in Perl.
Awesome.
So.
Now, speaking of things written in Perl, you will be able to find all of the notes from today's show eventually at our show notes page. We're going to give you the link to wherever we're going to end up holding all those nice juicy tidbits. And where can you find our show notes page?
That's over at twit.tv/code.
Yeah, yeah.
Yay!
Yeah, you can also find us on YouTube. You're going to find us at youtube.com/C twitcoding101. There you will be able to find all of our episodes. And, like, for example, when we do the special episodes with Joe Hecht, you're definitely going to be able to find that up there. It's a nice place for you to go and just speed through if you're ever looking for a reference point.
Yes, and I also create a playlist on there, so it's really easy to open up a module playlist and go straight through it if you want to watch episodes 1 through 8 of a specific programming language.
Yeah.
Also, we're still on iTunes.
Woohoo!
Yeah, we're still one of those top-rated shows on iTunes, at least I hope we are.
Yeah.
So subscribe if you haven't already. Definitely check it out over there. And of course, you could always download it from twit.tv/code as well.
Yes, you can. Speaking of Twit Coding, you need to be part of the Twit Coding G Plus community.
Yes.
Go to plus.google.com/twitcoding101. There you will find over 1,000 of our community members, the people who do this for a living, who want to do it for a living, or for the people who just want to figure out how coding works. Become part of the community, ask questions, give answers, be part of the awesomeness that is Twit Coding 101.
Yay, absolutely. And of course, send us your code examples because I love to show them off on the show and they also help me learn as well. So I really appreciate everyone who sends us their examples. And last but not least, we're also on Twitter.
Twitter, tweet, tweet.
What's your Twitter?
You can find me at PadreSJ. That's the little at symbol, PadreSJ.
And mine's easy. It's at Snubs.
Woohoo. And as always, we do the show every week live Thursdays, 1:30 p.m. Pacific time, PDT. So join us at live.twit.tv. You get to see the pre-show, the post-show, and any bloopers that we may cut out of the regular edit.
Like him for getting to turn off his mic when he goes to the potty.
That was me. Mm, go figure that.
So gross.
And as long as you're going to be part of the pre-show and the post-show, why not join us on our chat channel, irc.twit.tv.
Yes.
We pull people straight out of the chat room. We pull
literally, we pull them out.
Literally, like they're back
literally.
Here.
Yeah, they're dead. Hiding.
But you know, it's one of the things that we do. It's
sometimes
an experiment in the wonderful community on the interwebs.
I think that's about it for
that's
today.
That's about it.
I'm excited for next week, though.
I can't wait. I want the super secret Patrick Delahanty tease me about Perl gonna change my life on programming thing. But until that time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
I'm Shannon Morse.
End of line.
Standard input.